to take up our offering, you know, I just want to say, reinforce that the offering, the tithes and the offerings is a way of praising and honoring the Lord.
Absolutely.
You know, you in your home, you want to be praised and honored. Well, God wants to be praised and honored. And I got a little reading here that I want to do. It's from Kenneth Copeland, and he says, "Tied with joy." And Deuteronomy 26, 1 and 2 says, "And it shall be when thou art come in unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee for inheritance, that thou shalt take of the first of all fruit of the earth, and shall go unto the place which the Lord thy God shall choose to place his name there." You know, tithing, most Christians aren't very excited about it. That's not our church. I see our people excited about the tithing. But I have been in churches where it's not, people are kind of, "Oh, you mean we have to do that?" You know, they don't study this word and stuff to see the tithing is how you get the blessings from God.
Amen.
So,
amen.
So what they should be, and they would be if they understood how to do it properly. Spiritual tithing stirs up faith. It activates the power of God in our lives when we do it in gratitude and joy, expecting needs to be met abundantly. In Deuteronomy 26, 8, and 9, God told the Israelites exactly what to say when they brought their tithes. He instructed them to acknowledge the fact that he brought them out of the bondage of Egypt and to say, now, can you reflect back in your life what God has done for you and what he's brought you out of? That's what we need to do. The Lord brought us forth out of Egypt with a mighty hand and with a great outstretched arm, and with great trembleness and with signs and wonders. And he had brought us into this place and had given us this land, even a land that flowed with milk and honey. What does that have to do with you and me? God has done the same thing for us. He's brought us out of a life of bondage and poverty into a life that flows with abundance of God. So when you bring your tithe to the Lord, follow the example set by the Israelites. Make it a time of rejoicing. Make it a time of realizing anew the wonderful things Jesus Christ has done for you. Thank him for delivering you from a land of darkness and sanctity and bringing you into this promised land of plenty. Thank him that it is a land of mercy, a land of joy, a land of peace, and a land of prosperity. Tithe in faith, expecting the rich blessings of the land to be multiplied to you. You may soon find it to be one of the most exciting things you can do.
Amen. Amen.
We praise the Lord for that. And then I'm going to encourage you, Deuteronomy, read that whole chapter, Deuteronomy 26, and you'll get a better understanding why you want to tithe and the blessings and the pleasures and the joy you'll get out of it by being obedient
Amen.
To God's word.
Amen.
So I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. We're going to take up our tithes. And Debbie, you got a song this morning?
Dream of, you have poured your favor on me. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I gotta give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. More than I could hope or dream of, you have poured your favor on me. One day in the house of God is better than a thousand days in the world. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I gotta give it away. taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. You're more than enough for me. Lord, 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 you're more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me. So blessed, I can't contain it. So much I've got to give it away. Your love taught me to live now. You are more than enough for me.
As we take communion, you take that host, you take that, because this, it's bread, it's made out of, there's flour, but this is the bread of life. This is representing the bread of life. The bread of life is Jesus Christ, and what has Jesus all have in him? Every promise. He has the six-course meal in the heavenlies waiting for you to come and take from that six-course meal. Psalms 23. And then he says, he goes so far. He says in Psalms 2:7. He says there's no time in heaven. There's time on earth for us, but there's no time in heaven. So he says, your special day, Stephen Glottemans, remember that? Your special day, he told me, that just goes over my, years ago he told me that already. Then he told me not to. That was his day. That's your day. Well, guess what? Happy birthday. Every day is your day because there's no time in the heavens. So you can go and take what you want. Do you need peace? Take it. Do you need healing? Take it. Do you need, what do you need? Take it by faith. Father, wait a minute. I have that coming to me. I have it coming. Didi, give me my Bible. I just said my Bible.
Be obedient.
She gave it to me, and I take it by faith. I have to take it. I have to take it. I have to take it. If we don't take what belongs to us, oh my goodness sakes, we're losing out. So we take by faith what God has laid up in the heavenlies for us. Everything that's written in this Bible, 8,000 promises, all belong to us.
Amen.
This morning, I'm going to explain how to get it, too.
Yes.
As the men are back there working on stuff. Well, we have the blessings right here, are all of those 8,000 promises. What do you have need of? I was busy taking it during praise and worship, and as I was explaining to the women this last Thursday, Friday, Saturday, was it Thursday or Friday? We really got into it. Girls, what does that mean? Oh, yeah. Then God can take what's not good in us. But then he gives us in return the blessings. He gives us his blessings. He gives us His blessings. But guys, you got to take it by faith. And it will become a material thing in your life. The blessings of God. I'll say this again. I would rather live in a little junky house, a little junky car, than to have all the money in the world. Money does not make you happy. Oh, it'd make me happy, Pastor Jan. No, it would not make you happy if there's greed behind it. But God, listen, I saw this one family a long time ago. They didn't have diddly squat. But they had so much love. It was beyond words. I think they had 12 kids. That's when I was young. They had 12 kids. Their last name was Deermeyer. They were the happiest people around. We, Mom and Dad, we had money. They didn't have it. They did, but they had happiness. You know what we had in our house? Misery. It wasn't good. You would not have liked to grown up in my house. Got it? Now I've taken on a new home. I got a new daddy. I got, you know, Donald Trump, there's a new sheriff in town. I got a new daddy. The day I got born again, I got a new daddy. I shifted my gears. I've given it all to Him. Girls, you know what word I'm using? I gave it all to Him. So that I can receive His highest that He has laid up in the heavenlies for me. Can you receive that? Can you take it by faith and then meditate on it? Can you do that? Well, let's do it right now. Father God, I take by faith. Now you've got it in your mind what you need. And say, I receive it. In Jesus' name. Oh, and I'll break it and eat it because He died for you. Then this symbolizes, this grape juice symbolizes His blood. His blood has covered each and every one of us. His glove head, his blood has made us perfect, just, upright. He says, whatever you ask me, I will give it to you. Because, God says, because of what my Son Jesus Christ did just for you. He didn't do it for Himself. He did it for us. Do you receive that? Then let's drink. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Well, we're going to start, and the men are going to be released. Whoever wants to go, you can go back. If you don't want to, you don't have to. Life will go on.
We just we also pray a blessing over our tithes and offerings this morning.
Yes.
We give all God all the glory and honor for those. We give God the glory and honor that we have the opportunity. We can come into this house and bring our tithes and offerings. And the business people in Door County, they're joyful this morning for them.
Woohoo! Girls, we done good. Did we do good? We did good. Yoo-hoo. But listen, I tell you, but listen, just when the guys are leaving now, hey girls, let's have your attention. Did we get more spiritual food, more spiritual blessings than clothes blessings?
Yes. And
there we go. Father, we thank you for that in the precious name of Jesus. Now, we're going to read Ephesians, and we're going to go to chapter 3 because we got some people that have got more understanding of that since this weekend. One of these days, I'm just going to start laying that whole thing right out, so pure, so holy. But you know what? I got to share this with you. Do you know what? You get people together that are hungry, they will pull the word out. I didn't understand that for a long time. You may be seated. We'll stand in a minute and just give you a break. But pulling the word out, I did not understand that until Dr. Dollar shared that with the sons and daughters. You know, he gets raw with us. When I mean raw, he gets raw. Okay? And Keisha understands that. She says, oh, yeah, we black folks weren't like that. Yeah, well, I found out. And it was good. But when he got up there, I was pulling stuff out. And after a while, when we're at lunch, I'm talking to this other couple. She didn't hear anything I heard. And I thought, did I hear the wrong scripture? So then I talked to somebody from Dr. Dollar's staff there, you know, that we get to talk. And they said, oh, no, you got it. And she said, did you hear what Dr. Dollar said? And I said, he said a lot. He said, when you're hungry, you will pull a lot out. It's like a nursing baby that's hungry. You will pull out of him that he hasn't even studied yet, that he hasn't even gone over yet. I said, you gotta be kidding. You get a boatload full of that. How can you get such an overflow? You got to think, I got to swallow here. I'm just so excited. Well, God's got such a boatload. But you know, sometimes maybe I feed you too fast and you miss things. But that's when you got to take the Word of God and make it first place in you. But now we will stand for this. We're standing in, not in my presence, but you're standing in His presence. Whenever you stand in His presence, you're showing Him, I'm ready to march on. I'm a soldier. I'm ready to take. Do I stand that right? Give it to me. How do you stand? That soldier. I'm ready. I'm ready. Are you ready? I was born ready. Okay. Hey, I should go away more often. Well, these girls got me so going. I mean, you know what? It feels so good when you've got something in you that you can release. You know what I mean? It feels good to get together with somebody and release, and they're pulling it out of you, and you're going, oh, my goodness, 3 hours has gone by, and I'm still not done. So this is what it says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14. And why are we saying this? Why are we saying we bow our knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ? Because we are getting strength through the Spirit of God. That's why we're bowing our knees and we're praying it. When, you know, when, did you ever get into a situation where, you've all been there, where you're really tired out and it's like, what do you mean go one more mile? I never ran in a marathon or anything like that. But did you ever go and you had to go one more? I've had... And I used to do more counseling and stuff at night. Pastor Kenny said one time to me, he said, that's enough. That's enough. And I was like, he said, you can't keep on giving out. You're going to get tired out. And so I had to start kicking back, you know, a little bit. But I didn't realize I needed to be with Kenny. I needed to be with him. Just like we need right now to be with God. But when we neglect, and we're not together as much as you guys are together, we're not. But when our time together, like last night when I got home, we sat and talked. We just sat and talked, and we talked. Do you see? It's not, well, we got to spend time together. Well, look at that on TV, will you? Well, look at that person's doing it. Is that spending time together? I can watch that TV alone. I can listen to a tape alone. But when you're spending time together, you're looking at each other, you're talking, you're communicating. You can spend 5 minutes together talking and 2 hours in front of the TV, and that 5 minutes will give you a whole lot more than that 2 hours in front of a television. Right? But you know, we get ourselves, and we're going to share a little bit of that. We get ourselves into a routine that, we're spending time together, Kenny. This is really good. No, it's not. It's not really good. That's not spending time together. You are spending time together, but are you gleaning from each other? Or what are you watching on the boob tube? What are you watching on that? You know, I heard what I said. That's right. That's what it is. It's, come on. Why watch something that's not, there's good things in there. Don't get me wrong. But when your focus is around television, you know, especially wrestling, that fake wrestling. I'm like, Kenny, you got to be kidding. And sometimes Mary, I'll sit and watch him with her for about 15 minutes. And I'm making fun of, I said, look at, did you see him do that? This is fake. And we're laughing. It's like entertainment. But seriously, are we spending time together? Guys, spending time together means communicating. Okay, we were talking a little bit about that. You know, the cell phone. Pretend Dee Dee's got her cell phone on. I got mine out. And we're in the same room. We're sitting next to each other. Well, we're communicating. What does an exclamation mark mean when you put it after a word or a sentence? What is it saying? It's saying what?
Emphasis.
Emphasis on what?
Whatever you said.
It can be excitement. It could be anger. It could be disgust. It could be anything. Do you get it? So now, when you're texting, you can put those things, but what did they mean? When you get back to communicating, you know, like we gals were communicating, it's so fun because we get to know each other better. You know, and just share, and we laugh, and we look, and, you know, it's good. It really is, because you're getting to know each other's heart. But how about our husbands? How about our children? Do we really get to listen to them? Or texting? Do you see what I'm saying? So now we're getting strength through His Spirit when we pray this. When we pray this, we're getting strength through His Spirit. And that's what you want to do. You want to get His heart. You want to get what God has. You want to see that six-course meal and take it by faith. That's what you really want to get. So it says in here, for this cause, for what cause? For the cause that the strength from the Holy Spirit is coming, that I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That means, God, I'm going to take you first. I'm going to take you first. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all of these things will be given unto you. What things? The six-course meal, all the 8,000 promises are given to you. So he says in here, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that, Father, you would grant us according to your riches and glory, that we'd be strengthened with your might by your Spirit in our inner man, and that, Christ, you may dwell in our hearts by faith. What? By faith? That we would be rooted and grounded in love. Do you want to be rooted and grounded in His love? I'm not talking about rooted and grounded in people's love. I'm talking about His love. You get rooted and grounded in His love, and you're going to be able to give your love. You're going to be able to understand things. You're going to be able to discern right from wrong. So we'll be rooted and grounded in love, that we may be comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. And we would know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ask or think, according to that power that worketh in us. Unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. You take that scripture and you start breaking that down. And look up some, well, you don't have an interlinear. I look up the Greek words. I want to get a better understanding. And you even look up exclamation mark. What does that mean? When you see something in the word, when you see something somebody's texting, what do you exactly mean? You know this new way, that laugh out loud? Somebody did that one time. I said, what does LOL mean? Laugh out loud, Pastor Jan. Did you know that? I did. Come on, you guys. Kick back a little. In fact, we decided this weekend we like the old school. Is that right, girls? We like the old school of doing things, and that's the Word of God. So thank you, Father. Thank you for that overflow. Thank you for increase in the wisdom and revelation of you. Thank you, Jesus, as you release it through your word now in the precious name of Jesus. Do you receive that? Amen. Amen. Then you take it by faith. Well, let's just be seated. Now, I'm talking about, you know, we want to get into an agreement like Matthew 18, right? We want to make a prayer. Make a prayer, right? And when we make a prayer, God immediately goes into effect with that prayer. It's like if I turn around, you're being in the military, if anybody in the military, you give them something and you say, here, you go deliver that to General so-and-so. How long is it going to take you to go? You're going to, I don't make fun of that, I don't know how to do that, probably, but you're going to salute or whatever you're going to do. You're going to turn on your heels and you're gone. Is that true? Do you stop and visit with other people and say, I'll get to it tomorrow? You get it done. See, that's God. God's the general. He gets it done now. So when you speak it, it becomes a reality. There is no time in heaven. Do you realize that? God has miracles waiting in the heavenlies, 8,000 of them for us. Now what we have to do is take it by faith. So how are we going to do this? We want to keep the river flowing, right? I think I'll use that next week, but I'll tell you something real good. Okay. How many of you ever seen a creek that was dammed up by beavers? You can tear that dam down. What and you go back the next day, what are you going to see? You're going to see the dam again. Those little puppies will get their friends to come over and build. Didn't you ever see that? There was a dam on Old Maid's Creek when we lived in Freedom. And they tried to get, so my dad is helping other guys get that down because they needed the water down, right? They're knocking that thing about. You go the next day, and you're thinking, I'm going to wear those beavers out. Did he wear out? No. They keep on, somebody's got to give. Somebody's got to give. You can take that wood and you can drag it miles away. Next day you come back and where did you get that from? They had to dig it out of the earth or something. But I remember seeing that. And then sometimes I don't know why the beavers must come out at night. Beavers come out at night? We didn't really see them. We saw otters up at our cottage in the water. But those beavers, they just work. Those little teeth, they could chew anything apart. When you get, we're going to work on this because we're going to renew our minds. Because what do we want to take first place? We want to take the Word of God first place. When you take the Word of God and you put it first place and you meditate on it, okay? And let's say that the enemy, who is the beaver, comes along and builds that dam. And you think in your mind, I've got this all taken care of. You get up the next day and you, why am I feeling this? Why is this happening again? Why? I looked at this and everything looked good to me. But I got the same bills, got the same problems, I got the same kids. Nobody would trade their kids for my kids. You look at that and you go, what happened? But did you meditate on it? Joshua 1:8 says, meditate on it night and day. I used to think, Lord, I got to sleep. What's that about? Well, he says, if you wake up during the night and the enemy is attacking you, the word that you meditate on will set you free. The word that you have meditated on will set you free. What words are you meditating on? When I got Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and 9, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, Jan. Oh, what do you mean? Lean not on your own understanding. What? Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he'll make your path straight. Don't be wise in your own eyes. Awe the Lord and shun evil. I'm thinking, what? You see where I'm getting? But when I sat down and took the scripture and word by word, I started getting a picture. Trust in the Lord. How do I trust in you? Well, he's got keys. He's got the keys of the kingdom. And he says to meditate on Joshua 1:8. He says, meditate on the word of God. Why would I meditate on the word of God? Because when those beavers come back and those beavers start to dam up that creek again, and I got to have that water from the creek or I'm going to die. We need water of the word. We need the word of God. I need the word of God to keep me going, you guys. You need the word of God to keep you going. You need the word of God. Listen, some of you guys tire out before me and you're much younger than me. But it's the word of God that sustains us. It's a word of God that gives you hope. It's a word of God that gives you peace. It's the word of God that says, I can do this. But so many people give up, even born-again Christians give up, and they kill themselves. They're like, well, I don't care. I'm just going to do whatever I want because God's going to do whatever he wants. No, 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 no. God cannot do whatever he wants. He set himself in agreement. He set himself in agreement with Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and he said, in Genesis 1:26, I give, put your names in there, Pastor Jan, put your name, all the dominion on this earth because you're a speaking spirit. When you have Jesus into your heart, you've got the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now he says, speak the word of God. Why would I do that? Well, I just want to have some time off and just say what I want to say. Well, go ahead. Bake a cake, ladies. you get in the middle of that recipe, I'm going to put in what I want. Like a breakfast. And a kid put something there that isn't the best. Whoa! It'll wake you up. But in the middle of the cake, I'm going to put in salt instead of sugar because I'm going to do it my way. And if I invite you over and you're very important and you sit down to eat that cake and I say, you know what? I love you so much. I made this just for you and I gave you a big piece. And because I love you so much, I made it so good. You're going to eat the whole thing. I know you're going to because that's the kind of person you are. You just so much appreciate things when I give them to you and you take the first work. Well, you're like, oh, I can't disappoint her. Do you get it? You cannot stop in the middle of the word and do whatever you want. When you have got a prayer request out there and you've got an image you want to fulfill, you can't stop in the middle and put salt in instead of sugar. You can't stop in the middle and put evil in and expect good. You see what we do? I still remember. I was 8 months pregnant with Kenny Jr., almost 8 months, and I changed my mind. Because my neighbor lady was talking about how hard it was to birth a baby. She says, when you feel like climbing the walls, the baby's ready to come. And I was like, she left my house. And I said, I changed my mind. There was no turning back. The salt was in the cake. And it was baked. I couldn't change it. I had to go through with it. Do you see what I'm saying? You know, when we take the word of God and when we meditate on that word of God, what happens to us? You get a picture of it. Just think, we're doing the dream it, pin it, live it. But let me just give you something before, because the Lord said, just back up a little bit. You know how he talks to you, so just back up a little bit. You're putting not enough sugar in there, Jan, just do it right. Okay, Psalms 112:7. This is the Living Bible. Listen to this. He does not fear bad news. Who? God's children. We want to establish the scriptures in us. You will build upon the scriptures. When I got born again, when I started getting the truth of God's word from Ed and Janet, I started building on the scriptures. I didn't go right into Revelations, get a real life. I had no idea what it was saying. I got more messed up. I would have, but I was smart enough not to go there. But I was smart enough when they said to me to go Genesis, read Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3. I was smart enough to do it. And then they started teaching me on that, and I was like, I didn't know there was that much in there. It was delicious. I was getting the most delicious food you could ever imagine. So now, why? Because I learned how God operates, because in Isaiah 55, what does it say? My ways are not your ways. My ways are higher than your ways. So he's saying the way you think it should be, is it right or wrong? It could be totally wrong, or it could be totally right. Okay? Now, I'm going to go back to the cake. Dee Dee, would you eat a full piece of cake that I put a cup of salt in? Okay, this is what I want to do. I want to bake some cookies. But I'm going to put a tablespoon of oregano in it, the oil. Debbie, would you eat my cookies? See, when you take the word of God, you have got you've got the whole recipe, you've got the right amount of everything you put in. But you've got to make that first place. And again, you don't stop in the middle and say, well, instead of oregano today, I'll put thyme in. Ooh. I'll put rosemary in today, you know. You don't do that, and I'm laboring that to show you something. But look at here. In Psalms 112:7, it says, he does not fear bad news. When you get the word of God and you've meditated on it, you do not fear bad news, nor live in dread of what may happen. For he is settled in his mind. Who is he? When you meditate on the word of God, when you meditate on the word of God, that means that I'm going to take a scripture, like for instance, I'm going to take John 10:10. The first part of 10:10 says, the thief only comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Just showed his character. sounds a little bit like me. I got some of those things in me. Wow, okay. Now, the second part of it, see, I got to meditate on that. Do I have some of those things in me that I need to get rid of? Then the second part says, what does he, but Jesus came to do what? Jesus came to do what? But Jesus came, give us what? Life in abundance to the full, to the overflow. Does God do bad things to us? How many times haven't we've heard that other places? You know, God did this and God did that. Well, just looking in 1 Samuel, what does it say there? What did they said? They said an evil spirit from God came into Saul. Does an evil spirit from God go into a person? Where would he get it from? He doesn't have evil. So here it's even a capital G in there. Years ago when I saw that, I was like, whoa. But now when I see a scripture, I can pick it, I can discern. I can discern. No, God doesn't have an evil spirit. Because James 1:17 tells me, every good and perfect gift is from above that cometh down from the Father of lights, whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. And he doesn't have evil. He can't have it. See, once Satan, Lucifer, decided, you know, I'm going to take over his throne. He was not in heaven saying that. He was on the earth, going through and full. You see what? Music. And what happened? God says, there's no evil in heaven. You can't even come back here. You're flung to the earth forever. Got it? There is no evil in God. There is only evil in the devil. But the devil cannot get you to do one thing you don't want. He cannot get you. God cannot get you to do one thing he wants. He has given us a free will. And we have to receive the evil or we have to receive the good. You know, you can sit here and say, I'm not receiving any of this. This is a bunch of garbage. Matthew says, I don't believe her. That's his right. But he won't receive, will he? Okay. Then his mama and his sister, they can receive it. Got it? So we can choose this day whom we're going to serve. Deuteronomy 29 tells us, 30:19 says, choose this day whom you're going to serve. Choose. Are you going to listen to the bread of life or are you going to listen to the bread of evil? There's always two sides. There's a coin. There's a heads and there's a tail, right? Well, it's up to us, whatever we do. So, but let's get to, remember, we're going to seek ye first the kingdom of God. Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God. God is saying, the kingdom is right here. Seek this word. Get this word in you first. But Pastor, I've been reading it. Well, let's look at some scripture. So if we take and seek the kingdom of God, then all of these things will be given unto us. All the 8,000 promises when we have need. He says, this is to us. He says, remember, these are letters. This is written to you. This is the letters written to you. So you can know good and evil. Okay? So you can know what belongs to you. You go to school. You want to learn to be an electrician. You want to learn to be, I don't care what you want to learn to be. You've got to go and learn to do it. You can't just walk in and do it. Even a waitress, you can't just walk in and do it, okay? I don't mean even a waitress, because I tell you, I appreciate good waitresses. We had a good one last night for dinner, just sweet, nice. You turn around and, you know what, this is the thing, and Debbie attests to this too. We're done, and she wasn't trying to get anything from us. Money is coming out of our wallets and going extra on that. Why? She earned a blessing from God because she was good to God's children. We were all God's children. She's going to get the better deal. We think we're giving her such a, you know, give her 5, 10, 15, 51. One time, was you with me? We give $51 for what, $6 meal? That guy that time didn't get blessed. That girl that time, last night didn't get blessed. We got the blessings. Because you sow a seed, you're always going to get a harvest. You sow one, okay? They receive that one, but we're getting back the harvest from God. And is it a hundredfold? It's whatever you can imagine. Got it? So now, and this is Romans 12:2 in God's Word translation. Don't become like the people of this world. Instead, change the way you think. I don't want to be like the people of this world. I don't like to be like the actors and actresses and the way they're behaving with President Donald Trump. Hey, even if they would have done that with any other president, I don't care who it would be. It is so disrespectful. It just makes me look at him and think, man, I used to like to watch movies that you were in. And now I look at him and I saw a clip that this one person was going to be in. And I thought, oh, that'd be funny, you know, when it started. And then I saw this person and I went, all of a sudden it turned me right off. Why? Because that person was working for evil. I discerned it just like that. I will not buy that movie. I will not watch it. I will not give 1 cent to that person. Do you see? Because their movies, do you know it's going really down bad? The bad. Do you know the Christian ones are rising up and the bad is going down? Amen. Thank you, Debbie. Don't become like the people of this world. Instead, change the way you think. I'm gonna bring this up again. Okay. Like the men right now, they're learning. Okay? Let your men learn on their own. Oh, we got to do everything together, Debbie. Here's Pastor Kenny and I, and we're walking together. And then we got to walk to the bank together. And then we got to go to the grocery store. And then pretty soon I say, you make me sick. I mean that in a way that the only one I can walk with and that is going to edify and help me to grow, really grow, is the Lord Jesus Christ. That's who I want at my side, just constantly there. Listen, Kenny's a good man. You all know that. I love the boy. I'm the mess. I really was, and many times I still am. I confess it at least, right? So, but when you're walking with God, you know, a lot of times you're not even walking. He picks you up and he carries you. Isn't that neat? When last year again, when we were, this older lady, she was 82 years old, and we walked on the beach, okay? And she asked me, would you walk on the beach with me? And I was just going to go, and I thought, I want to spend time with you, Jesus. And she said, would you go with me? And I went, okay. Did you ever feel like somebody stole your time? Okay. She put her arm in mine and down the beach. Debbie, we went a long ways, but we didn't get sunburned. That's just... And we are walking, and this lady, her heart is pouring out of her life. Her heart is pouring out. She said, I've never told people 3 different things, and she told me. She said, do you know how good that feels to release that? I feel like I walked with Jesus, she said. He used me! She felt like she walked with Jesus. But I want to have my time. But as we walked along and we're going back, and then after a while, you know, we were at the condo and the people got together. And she came down, gets her plate, she comes over there, she's, I'm sitting by you. I couldn't shake her after that. I didn't want to shake her. We sat and we talked, and her gentleman looked and said, boy, you look younger. Because she had stuff in her that she released because she had somebody to listen to. But she knew in her heart, and she told me that when we were saying goodbye. She's, you know, I trusted you with things, and I knew when I met you the first time. No, when I saw you sitting at that table outside, I knew you would never share any of my secrets with anybody. That was after it was all over. She didn't tell me that before. Okay? You think, Jesus, you used me and it felt so good and I can still see her. I can still feel her love. I can, you know, and we talked a few times after that on the phone and just, God just wants to use us. God just wants to love on people through us. Why not? And the wonderful thing about it, I said, God, I don't ever want to slip and ever tell her secrets to nobody. Just like your secrets, I don't ever want to tell them to anybody else. And so many times I've forgotten things you people have told me. But God takes it and dumps it into the deepest of oceans. Never to be brought up again. God is good. I like that. So now, don't become like the people of this world. Instead, change the way you think. Don't try to change your mate. Don't try to change your children. You see what I'm saying? Change you. Then change the way you think. Then you will always be able to determine what God really wants, what is good, pleasing, and perfect. You know, we girls kid sometimes, and I think it's true. This is my mission. I'll marry that sucker and I'll change him. And then I'm the one that changed. I didn't think of that. Maybe I wasn't smart enough, but I was so busy getting drunk, that didn't, you know. But how many people don't you hear that? You know, I love this and that about him, but I'm going to change that, you know. God's working on us all the time to change us, and here we're busy. You know, here we got the screwdriver, and we got the, what do you call that thing, the drill, you know, all that stuff you use for different stuff. But we don't have nothing to work on. So we got to turn it on ourselves and work on ourselves. And I love it. I love it when I can open up and praise God and say, God, take all the dirt and the drizzard and the dross and take it, because I don't want to give it up. Because I've been hanging on to it so long. It feels so good. But God says, renew your mind, Jan. Change your thinking. So now, so that I can do the good and pleasing and perfect will of God. That's what my heart is. You know, and I said this to the girls, sitting there and talking, and one came with a wonderful testimony. And I don't care how small it is. To me, it's such a seed. It's such a, you know, and to hear how they've taken and changed something about themselves. Not about their family. Not about their siblings. Got it? So in the Living Bible, it says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Okay, so Kenny had said he just sat down when I came. He turned on, I don't know what one it is, it Waters World. Waters, Jesse Waters, yeah. And anyway, Jesse Waters, you know who, he's on Fox, and he was interviewing people out there. Did you see that? He was here, that people were protesting. What were they protesting now? What was it? I don't know. It was a march again, protesting. Yeah, something that Donald Trump was doing now. They were protesting that, and he asked him what they were doing. Well, we don't like, but he brought specific things forth. One of the specific things was, one of the people said, "I'm protesting because this should be open borders. Anybody should be able to come into our country. This is God's, and this is mine, and I. And okay, that's good." And he turned and he said, "What countries are there a ban on?" Three different people asked that of. Not at the same time, but as he was getting this. Person. Pretty soon he said, "Well, you know, is it East? Is it Syria?" They mentioned three, each one of them mentioned names that the band wasn't even on. Do you get it? Do you realize Obama already had that band on those countries but didn't do it? Did he really? Really, was that? Do you realize Obama really started that? Really? What are you out here for? Because I don't agree. Well, what did you do? Do you see? It made no sense. They were out there because of evil, and they wanted to join the evil, but who were they hanging around with? Who were they hanging around with? Wow. Remember when I was young, with Dad, Mom with the tavern, and then with Romy's, you know, and you're behind that bar, and I was a bartender. I could take that beer, put a head on it, and slide it to the end of the bar, and it didn't go off because it was a little edge. But, you know, and you're so proud of yourself. That's what I hung around. Before you know it, they're buying you a beer. 10 cents a beer it was. Just, I don't know how much it is now, but you know what I mean? And then when you really look back at yourself, you go, oh, I must have looked so stupid. The Lord said, no, they were looking through the same eyes you were, drunken eyes. Do you see? We think we look so good until we look at the eyes of God and we look through his eyes. Now, we were talking about we knew the truth. We knew the truth about something. Come down the pike, we were wrong. Did you ever run into that? You say to somebody, I know this is the truth. I know that 2 and 2 is 3. Is that correct? No, I know it. I know it. And the more you do, the more you hang on to that evil and the more you protect it. Do you see what I mean? And then one day, Mary says, here, I'm going to give you your 2 and 2 in $100 bills. Now how much is 2 and 2? Oh, it's 4. $100 instead of $300. Do you see? She finally got to me. We're not going to wrap our minds around that right now all the way. How much is this? When you finally get it, you wrap your mind. When I had need of this, then I could wrap my mind around it. Before, I really didn't give a crap. 2 and 2 is 3. Oh, you're giving me a $100 bill for each one that I agree with you? Yes. And I finally see it right here. You see the word for the truth. This is the only truth there is. God cannot lie. The devil is a liar. He can't tell the truth. So now, we have to have the key to success. And remember, God says in Joshua 1:8, I'll read it to you from the King James, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written with therein. For then thou shalt make thy prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. So we take the word of God. Now listen, guys. I think the biggest problem we have, we really do in America, we really do, and that is we think of money right away. I want to prosper. Actually, people will sell their soul. Born-again Christians will sell their soul. What is their soul? Mind, will, and emotions. Remember, you ask Jesus into your heart. He's there. That's done. But you can sell your soul to the devil. You can sell your thinking to the devil. And you can become just like the people you hang around. Now, that's why we choose who we hang around, true? But now think in it. So if I sell my soul to the devil, I sell my thinking, I give him the right to think through my mind all those evil things, right? So now I've got that beautiful crick. We, like I said, the old maid's crick it was called, and because it was on their land. And that flow through there, oh, it was nice and flowing. It was beautiful. Until the beavers came along and they dammed it up. Those neighbor men would get together and down they would go, just like when the skunks were in the field. They'd get their sticks and their forks and they'd go after the skunks. Come back and they didn't smell too good. You see, when you've got to watch who you hang around. Now, you've got to hang around workers. You've got to hang around people when you go to the grocery store. You've got to hang around some things. Hey, But see, you'll discern what they're saying is wrong. But the gift here is that you get to pray for them. God sends you out there. You know, I want to get where it's all Christians working. Get a real life. What are you going to do, minister to each other and get fat? And this means just fat on the word. When are you going to give it out? When are you going to give it out? So now when you work someplace, you go there and you start to give it out. What? You don't sit and preach to them. God said you look like a fool. You don't throw the pearls among the swine. What you do is you listen. You can go in the other, maybe over here if you work at a building or work, you can go someplace, say, Father, I give them to you and I thank you for taking them in Jesus' name. You're working away. You know, they got radios on and stuff. A long time ago, there was two young guys who worked for us, and they were both Christians. And I remember them sitting at a picnic table at our house, and they were working on our house. And there was just something different about them. They didn't judge, but you knew their language was different than the rest. You just knew. You know what they even did? They opened up their lunch boxes, and they went like this. Not out loud. And I looked. And then there were some other things said. Got it? I knew who those boys were. It changed me. Did you see it? I already knew Jesus right there. I knew Jesus. I knew him. But that brought me so much closer into him. But it was like absolute, like right now, the lights are on. Let's say you turn off every light, cover the windows, it'd be totally dark. It took me from that darkness right into that light. See, it's not what you say, folks, because a lot of people have a lot of garbage coming out of their mouth. Oh, Dee Dee, you know, I'm really perfect. You know, Dee Dee, I don't ever do anything wrong. Dee Dee, my house is just, I can't lie. Well, I'll lie now. My house is perfect, and you should see my closets and my drawers. Everything is organized. I don't keep anything. You should see my refrigerator. I'm really lying. You know what I'm saying. But here I am, a braggadocious, and I'm the best thing that ever walked. She comes over, and she's like, oh, I'm in the wrong house. And I come out of the back room. Oh, you just kick that stuff aside, Dee Dee, and just sit down, sweetheart. Everything will be fine. But she made me believe that she was so perfect. Are you getting what I'm saying? We don't have to exaggerate about ourselves. We just have to have the Word of God and let Him diffuse His fragrance through us. But how many people are you touching with your fragrance? How many are? Do you ever, somebody smells good, a guy, nice lotion, a girl, a nice perfume or something like that? You say, you really smell good. You don't have to, I mean, I like to wear, like I like Abundance and the oil and stuff like that. But you know, those two young men were sweaty that sat at that picnic table. Their fragrance was sweet. Do you see what I mean? So we're not of this world. Is that true? So don't become like the world. Instead, change your way of thinking. The living, don't copy the behavior and customs of the world. But be a new and different person with a fresh newness in all you do and think. What do you mean, and think? Now I have to think. You never get a vacation. I never can do whatever I want. I don't want to be left to myself. I'm a mess. If I'm left to myself and do whatever I want. Hey, okay, let's say everybody's gone. I'm home alone, right? I know I'm going to be alone next week. I'll get some of that Breyers pecan ice cream. I'm going to bake a lemon pie. Oh, no, I know this bakery that has a beautiful, the lemon pie, the meringue is just, oh. Then I want to make some of that caramel corn. I take that 2 of butter, 4 of serpent, 6 of sugar, and then you pop the popcorn, you put that on, put a little salt on, and then I'm going to keep that. Ooh, then those nice chocolates, you know. Oh, I'm going to eat a couple of that. Everybody's gone. The curtains are closed, and I start. How am I going to feel when I'm all done? Not so good. When you're left to yourself, you can be dangerous, right? Well, we got a little dangerous this weekend. But, hey, we walked it off, didn't we? I think we did pretty good. We split hamburgers at the restaurant. We were, because they're too big to eat alone. So now what we have to do, the key to success is meditating on the Word of God. Now, think on this. In Psalms 1, 1, 2, and 3, the first three verses, what does it say? Oh, the joy of those who do not follow men's evil advice, who do not hang around with sinners, scoffing at the things of God, but they delight in doing everything God wants them to do. Folks, and I've said this here before, when I went up to the jail ministering to those men, again, 16 guys in the room, that's as much as you could have. I wasn't afraid of one of those suckers. I could have taken them down. They're a little taller than me, but I could have taken them down because I'd have the Word and I got Him behind me, God. Do you know, this is one of the studies, and Russ, the officer, left to go. He came and he said, they're serving lunch. I said, did you forget about us? No. I think he was outside the door listening. They got those big iron doors that clung. Well, anybody that's ever been there, you know that. I don't like the place. That's not going to be my hotel. I don't want to go stare. But one day when we're really working on it, this Alan, he was 68, 69. He was sitting next to me. They gave me a podium. But I said, you know, first I was sitting and the guy said, well, you know, you was at a podium, we can see you. But okay, so I stood up. I thought, why should I sit up here all this time for you suckers? Well, they needed to see. I think some of them were reading lips, too. When they finally got it, that, honey, you've been, now how many times have you been back in? Five. Two of the guys in my class were in there 12 times. Remember I told you that? 12 times in and out. This young blonde guy, 18 years old, young man, nice-looking young man. I could have adopted him. Nice, just like my kid's cute. Just sitting at way down the end of that table. And he's just got this all thing coming in. Another one. Well, this is only my second time. Well, the guy, this one I remember, he says, oh, you'll be back. Well, why would you? So I said, why would you check back into Crowbar Motel? But finally, this one fellow, I think his name was, well, I'll call him Michael. It's not Michael, though. That was his fifth time. That was his fifth time. And he was only like 35. And I said, where do you guys go? Because I was using these scriptures. Where do you go when you get out each time? Well, we go home. You go home. Oh, well, this guy, I said, well, do you want to tell us about it? Because they were free-flowing. They felt very comfortable with me, and, you know. And he says, well, he said, I said to him, why are you in here again? I thought you had it. You were telling me you had it. He said, well, I went back to my girlfriend. I said, same one every time? Well, yeah. Well, what happened? She turned me in. Wait a minute. You got out of that situation. You come up here, okay, for a year. And now when you get out, you're going to go back to her and to that same situation. I don't have any place else to go. I said, well, you'll be back. And they started getting it. Do you know he moved from Appleton to Milwaukee and squared away? When they started seeing that if you can't go back and change your present situation, you will be back because you're hanging with the same evil you did before. Now, I said too, yeah, you've come. And almost every one of them in there, I got born again. And I said, you're born again. But if you think you can go back and fight the devil, I said, you're just a baby on milk. You have to get in a strong church. You have to get, you know, what was happening, there was overflow, so they were shipping them here from other counties and stuff, you know what I'm saying? So to get that in them, like, like the light was going on, the light was going on, the light was going on, the light was going on. This one gentleman, I'll call him Peter, that's not his name, but I can see him. He was thoroughly enjoying it up there. He said, I will tell you this, though. He said, I come up here and I get 3 square meals. They make sure that I get my shots for diabetes. I said, yep, you're a lifetimer, aren't you? I don't know. I just know that guy's in prison somewhere. Because some of the other guys told him, well, don't you want to better your life? Doesn't this do blah, 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 blah? You see what I mean? See what I mean? See, when you go back into the same situation, you know what? When I asked Jesus into my heart, I could have went back to those same bars. I could have went back with those same people. I could have went back. But God was so far ahead of me, he started reaching out, and those friends pushed me out because I didn't drink and smoke and cuss and everything with them because I was fun. I didn't like messing with guys. I just loved that alcohol and that smoking, and, you know. Just think, if we would take the word of God and we would change, just renew our thinking. We were talking about that too this weekend. If we just change our thinking. How about if I'm in a neighborhood and it's just a scuzzy neighborhood, right? If I'm strong enough and I get myself a prayer warrior and I start, I'm praying for this neighborhood, I'm taking this, but what if that neighborhood is going to consume me? I better move. I'm going to take myself out of there, and maybe I want to move across town, but I better check where I'm going. Does that make sense? You want to always check, where are you going? What's happening? Get it? So now you're supposed to fix your mind on the word and dwell on it in your life. You're supposed to fix your mind. You know, and the thing that made me so good, and I haven't gotten letters for a while, but I was getting letters from different ones when they went back to their hometowns. Pastor Jan, I've got a job and I'm doing this. And I would just sit, and I kept those letters. I got them at home. It just made you cry to think, God, you're a user and you used me. Praise God. You used me. And that person is not going back again. This is how many years ago? There was a big fellow. He was a black man, came, and he had a girlfriend. Different girlfriend. Well, he's not even living in this state anymore. But he said, I got out. And they said, and he had been in 12 times and out. He said, I'm never going back. And then he looks, he said, that's not the woman. This is a good one. Do you see it? He got a good one that wouldn't lead him back into drugs because the other one lead him back into drugs. See it? So when you take the word of God and make it first place like he did, but he got out of that relationship that drug him down. But then he said, I'm moving because there's friends here that have been contacting me quite a bit. He had quite a testimony that he wrote me a 3-page letter. You know how good that makes you feel that God used you, but it's only God that can change their heart. I can't change nobody's heart. It's only God that can change their hearts. But the word of God is what changes our hearts. It changed me. It'll change you. Do you agree? Is God good? God is good some of the time. Oh, all the time. Let's stand. Thank you, Father God, for your word. Thank you, Jesus. As we're going to take this journey, Father God, not only this morning, but Wednesday night, but next Sunday, and we're going to continue to learn to break that dam that those beavers the devil cannot build that back up again in our creek. But then, Father God, if there's things we've got to break where we need that dam to stop things, those beavers will come, we'll hire them, they'll come in and they'll build that in 1 second, 2 seconds, never to be tore down again. Father, I thank you in the precious name of Jesus. We give every evil thing that's hanging on to us. Just put your arms up, please, please. I'm not going to look at you. Don't look at each other. Just say, Lord, I give you every evil thing that has held me back
from growing in your kingdom.
I give myself totally to you.
And I thank you for taking me.
And I thank you for taking all that junk.
Show me what that junk is day by day.
So I can release it all to you.
And I thank you, Father.
In Jesus' name.
And they all said,
Amen. Glory to God. Now, Father God, I plead the blood of Jesus over each and every one here. I plead the blood of Jesus over little Israel, over the Jews. Protection, Father God. We stand with the Jews. God, you said, whoever stands with the Jews, I stand with them. Well, Satan, you could not work through Obama to take us away from the Jews. Uh-uh. We're tighter than ever. And Father God, our president is going to help to put the capital in Jerusalem where it belongs. And I stand on that in the precious name of Jesus. I thank you, Father God, for the Jews. Because the Jews gave us what? Jesus. And they gave us America. They gave the money to the Queen Elizabeth. For who? For the ships that brought them over here, the pilgrims over here, to discover this country. Do you understand that? Father, I thank you for that. You are the God of more than enough. Now, Father God, I bless each and every one of you. Because you said we're to bless people. It's not us, but it's the Holy Spirit doing it through us. And I thank you for that. Bless Donald, President Donald Trump and his family, his cabinet. We're to pray for our leaders. And that's what we've done. And we thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Do you agree? Amen. Amen. You have a wonderful day. Amen and glory to God.